know, yesterday I put a lot of rain fell. Oh, Trinidad gets rain every day. But I thank God that up until now, no rain has stopped immediately. Yeah, even the rain falls. Okay, now, I want God for something now. But now, brother, could you take up this one, please? This, so that they put it on some place. Yes. Hey. Yes, this. Thank you. Take it up. Move it up. You need somebody to help you with your chalkboard, huh? Yes. No, the chalkboard is here, but you need somebody to help him. He needs his twin brother. Yeah, he needs his twin brother. But look at, well, listen, the twin brother is here. Yeah, the twin brother is here. Hold on. Wait. Come, put it back this way. You know, of all the shoes that I've, put it back that way. Of all the shoes that I've seen, yours is the best, you know. Don't slant it. Put it straight. Tonight, all those of you who are paid for the series, pick up your first week. Get in here, me.
Amen.
Oh, me, what happened? I say, pick up your first week.
Praise the Lord.
And you sit down there, you pay your money, you pick up your thing. Why don't you say amen for that?
Amen.
I say, the first week is ready. Hallelujah. Y'all in here, they didn't understand what I was
Hallelujah.
Saying. The first week is ready.
Yes.
Ready like Freddy. So come and get your first week. And listen now, this is not for making money. This is a service to you. And I will encourage everybody, even though you think you can't afford it, sacrifice and get the series so that you can, because what you're getting here, you can't remember it. Not everything. And you need to go over with your Bibles open. Sit down in your living room, you're alone, and go over. Come on, am I talking to you?
Yes.
You can go over it for a year if you want to, every night.
Yes.
And if you don't learn something every night for a year, you don't want to learn again. So make sure you get the series. Make sure you all get it. And sister, you better go pay your money right now, fast. And not now, when I finish here. Yeah, when I finish here. You had enough time to, you know, to get the... All right, now, tomorrow night is going to be a big night. That's a ceiling of the 140 and 4,000. But I'm warning you, you got to come here thinking. You cannot come here just to be fed. Think for yourselves. In other words, we are going to dig in the scriptures to find the answer.
Amen.
The relationship between the 144,000 and the great multitude. Now, get me a little up here, please. Now, tomorrow night, I want you to listen to what I told you all. You got to read Genesis 32, Hosea 12, and Revelation 7. That's what I said? No, I said tomorrow night. For tomorrow night. And it is tomorrow night that I am expecting to see you all with the great controversy. Yes. Oh, yes. We are going to pray now. We are going to pray. Now, on Sabbath, the subject is the dragon and the woman. Ah, yes. That's going to be something else. And I said, all of those. Now, we still have some people that have lingering doubts about whether or not Mrs. White is the prophet to the remnant church. Oh, they feel they can go without a prophet. They don't need a prophet. You ever heard people say that?
Yes.
You have some Seventh-day Adventists who are saying that?
Yes.
Now, and those of you who are new converts, who may have had somebody come and tell you, well, you must believe in Ellen White without giving you a reason. Well, have no doubt. On Sabbath, you will get the reason.
Amen.
Come on.
Amen.
Did you all hear me?
Amen.
I say, God's willing, on Sabbath, you will get the reason. And after that, you will go and tell people that you are part of the remnant.
Amen.
Yes, and we are going to define the remnant on Sabbath morning. The remnant of a seed. Yeah. The dragon was wrought with the woman. Yes. Let us open to Revelation 6. We're going to pray. Don't think I'm going to read without praying. I'm only throwing out some water. Yes, let us all stand for prayer. Let us bow our heads. O eternal and everlasting God, what a privilege you have given me personally to stand here before your people. For you know, these are your people, the apple of your eye. As weak and feeble as we may be, you cast your highest regard on us. And you have given us a message for the last days.
Yes.
And we believe that we are living in the last days.
Yes.
God, you said to Daniel, shut up the words and seal it unto the time of the end. For many shall run to and fro. And knowledge in the book of Daniel shall be increased. So tonight, O God, please expand our minds that the Holy Ghost may give me the wisdom to teach and your people might have understanding hearts that they may use this knowledge to save themselves and to help you save somebody else. Lord, I thank you in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Let us turn to now, I didn't comment on the singing tonight, the special music. But I want to commend Alden. Alden, well done. I say, Alden, well done. Yeah, and I noticed that you had two backups. You know, Alan, we were calling your name just a while ago before you sang, you know, because we were looking at names in the Bible, and Lyndon is not in the Bible, nor Alice, neither Lewis, But I understand that your second name is Josiah. So that the others are trying to get in the kingdom on your hotel. Because you are Josiah, King Josiah.
Amen.
All right.
Amen.
Yes, but no. But apart from that, you know, mommy and daddy sang well to back you up. It was nice. I had to come around to see who it was. And it's a good thing I came to see. I noticed your dad was singing in his glasses. Well, that's a sign. Yeah, well done. He sings well. Very well. Now, my lead off text is, you know, we are studying the seven seals. Hold on, are you ready for it?
Yes.
Yes, it's a... I am still saying that you are a good audience. You know, I am a little anxious to come here at night to meet you all. You know, you all encourage people. And I'm not saying it to Mamagayu. Now, you know that word, Mamagayu? I lived in Trinidad. I remember I went to school here long before you were born. Yeah. 1972 to 1976. And since that, I've been coming to Trinidad at least twice every year. This second time I'm in Trinidad for this year. And I'll be coming again in November. God's willing.
Yes, Lord.
I was coming to Trinidad when the immigration was giving me trouble. Giving trouble. Yo, when you want 2 months to a crusade, they give you 1 month and say you got to come back. But now every time I come, they give me 6 months.
Amen. Amen.
So I can preach here for another 5 months or more.
Amen.
5.5 months.
Amen.
In Jesus' name.
Amen.
But I ain't staying here at home. No, I'm going home. Now I'm looking at Matthew chapter 16. Matthew 16.
Matthew
16. Chapter 16. And I want you all to notice that when you read Daniel chapter 12 tonight, you have not read it in vain. It has a lot of bearing on tonight's subject.
Amen.
Come on, I just mean now.
Yes.
Yeah, because we are going back to Daniel 12. Because a lot of information is in Daniel chapter 12. You see, some of us, we only read as far as, you know, Michael shall stand up. But that passage, that chapter, is pregnant with information about our time.
Amen.
Now, Daniel, Matthew chapter 16, verses 18 and 19. It says here.
Yes.
And I, come on.
And I say also unto thee.
Unto thee, everybody.
That thou art Peter.
Yes.
And upon this rock I will build my church. And the gates of hell shall not prevail against it.
Hold on. The gates of hell shall not prevail against what?
The church.
Against the church. Now, what does this tell you about the church?
Strong.
Come on. That there is a war.
Yes.
Come on. Are you with me now?
Oh, yes.
Hey, listen, folks. We all are here to reason. Come on, to think. God expects us to exercise common sense. You're not with me?
Yes.
Now, let me ask something. What is the difference between... What is the main difference you see between, say, dictation and spelling and mathematics? Is there any difference?
Yes.
Which one is tougher? Which one calls for brain work?
Mathematics.
Which one calls for just memory? Spelling, huh? Spelling. You got to remember, especially when you're dealing with English words. Because many times, the way it sounds, that's not the way it's spelled.
True.
For instance, I never could understand how on earth you can say, you know, a word like setsi. Now set C sound S-E-T, S-E, or S-Y, or S-I. But no, it is T-S-E, T-S-E. So you have to remember. Come on, I just know. I don't know how I'm saying it.
Yes, yes.
But when it comes to mathematics, yeah, there are some principles that you have to remember, but it calls for a lot of brain work. Well, that is the difference between Daniel and Revelation as opposed to other parts of the Bible.
Okay.
When you're dealing with Daniel and Revelation, you must be thinking.
All right.
You got a reason. Here is where you really need the Holy Ghost. More than ever. Not for you to remember, but to understand.
Amen.
You got to understand the principles. Now here it is. God is not going to hand feed his people. You see, there are times when we desire milk. I said there are times when God's people desire milk. And God expects them to drink milk. But then milk is for babes. Come on, let me know.
Yes.
Those of you who were baptized last year, you need now not milk but what? Hard food.
Yes.
Well, if you were baptized last year and need hard food, what about you? Now, they don't understand what I'm saying.
Yes.
Now, here it is, it's saying here, upon this rock, I am going to what?
Build my church
and the gates of hell shall not what?
Prevail.
Now it tells me, you know, for me, it is telling me that hell is going to battle the church.
Yes.
But what happens? But hell will not win the church.
Amen.
In other words, man, we got to have faith in the word of God. Even though you see the church bending over as if it's going down under me, the church may be leaning on a rope. But I'm saying all the church is doing is rope and up. Now, you all didn't see the 1974 fight between Muhammad Ali and George Foreman. George Foreman with his big heavy hands here, and all Muhammad Ali did was to steer on the rope, and George Foreman beat up himself here until the eighth round, Muhammad Ali knocked him flat on the ground. The church, listen now, the church will never go down.
Amen. Praise the Lord.
And the gates of hell shall not prevail against the church. And then it says something here. And I will what? Come on.
And I will give unto thee
what?
The keys of the kingdom of heaven.
The keys of the kingdom of heaven. What? Go ahead. Now read it. Continue to read.
And whatsoever thou shalt
bind on earth
shall be bound where? In heaven.
And whatsoever
thou shalt loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven.
Wow. The church is powerful. God has given the church the keys.
Amen.
Now, what are keys for? A key is to unlock.
Unlock.
That people might enter.
Amen.
So what is that saying, Pastor? All it's saying is that the church now, listen, man, God is saving people in the kingdom through his church.
Amen.
So then, if the church now closes its mouth, now suppose every 7 minutes were to shut their mouth. How will God save people? Because God is not sending an angel here. He's not sending the angels to preach. It's mankind. The church. Now you can understand why Satan hates the church, because the church has the message. So now we all know that Revelation is about the church, because now, let us back up a little. The woman was pregnant. Say yes, no? I say the woman of the church was pregnant.
Amen.
With the man child.
Yes.
Am I talking sense here?
Yes. Amen.
And the dragon tried to destroy the man child even before he was born.
Yes.
We'll talk about that on Sabbath.
Yes.
But eventually, the man child was born.
Yes.
Amen.
The man child is Christ.
Yeah, amen.
The man child, listen now, the man child was baptized.
Yes.
The man child ministered.
Yes.
The man child died.
Yes.
He rose from the dead.
Yes.
He ascended to heaven.
Yes.
And he left salvation now in the hands of the church.
Amen.
Now that Christ is back in heaven, Satan can't pester him anymore. So the Bible says that Satan now has turned his attention, all his fiery darts, all his ammunition are against the woman.
Amen.
And who is the woman?
The church.
Now, listen now. I want you all to know this. My brethren, Satan is against you. Well, for God's sake, keep it that way. Let Satan continue to be against you. Don't join Satan.
Amen. Praise the Lord.
I like to know that Satan is against me, because when he's against me, I know I am with God.
Amen. Hallelujah.
And now I have the keys to the kingdom. Boy.
Yeah.
Boy, I am powerful. I'm a big man in this world. You say, we are big people.
Yes.
Can you imagine? We got the keys.
Yes.
Hey, I want people understand what I'm saying here.
Yes, Pastor.
My sister, you got the keys to your house. When you open it, I mean, you got to go home and turn that lock for you and others to get in. But all that God is saying here, that if we don't use the open the kingdom of God to people, they will never be saved.
True.
Yes. On Sabbath, I'm going to show you all that the only way people can be saved is through the remnant.
Amen. Amen.
Now, I promise you that. I am not, you see, I have to have some things up my sleeve. I can't let out everything now. Otherwise, you all men will come on Sabbath. I know you will come.
Yes.
Now, we're going to be talking about the seven seals, because the seven seals represent the churches. I mean, the church. God has one church.
Mm-hmm.
Now, the Old Testament church symbolized the woman was pregnant, as I said, with a man child, and he went back to heaven. Christ came in his world to be man's savior. Yeah, and she shall bring forth a son, and thou shalt call his name what? Jesus. For he shall what?
Save his people from their sins.
From their sins. That's the only mission. That's the only thing Christ has to do. And the Apostle Paul said, I am crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live, yet not I. But Christ liveth where?
In me.
Let me ask now. Are you sure Christ is living in you? Don't answer me. No, no, don't answer me. Let it be a rhetorical question. Are you sure Christ is living in you? One certain thing. Listen now. Now listen to this. And she shall bring forth a son. And thou shalt call his name what?
Jesus.
For he shall. Well, if Christ is living in me, what is he living in me for?
To save
others. So if you are not willing to win souls, it's because Christ is not yet living in you. For your attitude not change yet. Yes. Now, in these seven seals, we are given the opportunity to view through the prophetic binoculars the struggle of the church against an enemy who is determined to wipe it off the earth.
Yes.
But more so, it is to underscore God's power to preserve and protect his church through the worst times.
Amen.
Come on, are you with me?
Yes.
Yes. God's ability to preserve his church through trying times. Yes, this is what happened now. And my friends, my brethren, God is going to land this church. They don't hear me. I said, God is going to land his church safely.
Amen.
Over on the other side.
Yes.
Now, I don't want anybody ever to think, well, you know, all that can be saved is 144,000. Listen, man, you all are belittling the power of God.
True. True.
How on earth you can ever think that's only 144,000 people? Come on, out of, you know, right now in this remnant church, there are over 16 million. And by if we live to see next general conversation, there will be 20 million plus.
Praise the Lord.
Well, are you telling me? Now, I know, no, I already know that all of us are not Israel. But rather, God has the vast majority of them. God has the vast majority of us.
Bless the Lord.
And not only that, but remember Ellen White said that in when the trouble comes, some of us are going to drop out. But a number was not lessened. God bless you.
Refill.
Well, come tomorrow night. Come tomorrow night. And we are going to find out the relationship between the 144,000 sealed, Israel sealed, and the great multitude. But make sure you don't come with preconceived ideas.
Okay.
Come with an open mind.
Okay, amen.
Clean slate.
Amen.
Uh-huh. Now we're going to study the seven seals. As I said, the seven seals represents the church. Satan battling the church. And God resisting. Come on.
Yeah.
Matters not how Satan thinks that everybody is wiped out. Isn't that nice? God has people always springing up.
Yeah.
When Satan beat them down here, they spring up there.
Yeah.
And when he goes over there, try to beat them down, they spring up over there. So who you think now has the worry? Is Satan has the worries?
Yes.
Because Satan is trying to prove that nobody is faithful to God. So every time somebody stands up, even one, Satan is proving a liar. Who you think won on Mount Carmel? Even the God has had, I mean, Satan had 850 prophets, and God had one. God was the winner.
Amen. Yes.
On the plain of Europe, Satan already boasted that nobody can withstand this fire. Everybody must bow down. So when three men stood for God, God won.
Amen.
You see, it's principle we're dealing with. Because God, I mean, behind the scene, God was able to look down at them and say, devil, you lie.
Alive.
And when Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, three teenagers, stood up, Satan turned away and he held on his head and walked.
Yeah.
He thought he had everybody. But I'm telling you something. When Elijah thought he was the only one, God said, fellow, I have 7,000. In other words, what's the ratio between 1 and 700? 7,000. It's 1 to 7,000. In other words, what God was saying, things are 7,000 times better than you think.
Amen.
So those of you who are pessimistic about the seven Adventist church, because you may see somebody wearing, I mean, lipstick and all these things and doing some stupidness in the church. And that's one person. Yeah. I have gone all around and I tell you the truth. Seven Adventists are wonderful people.
Yeah.
My brethren are wonderful. You see, once they get the right teaching, nothing can stop them. The problem is when they are not well taught. But some of you, these are your bad man cook. Because honestly, you can teach yourself. And I'll tell you how we are the bad man. Every one of you knows. Everybody in this district or in here know. Everyone knows that. Everyone's a distributed body. Everyone knows that what is happening here, they need to hear. And some of them for bad mind don't come here. Some of them even might even get on church board and fight against this. In other words, can I mean what are not going to cause members to fight against the information given to the brethren here to save their soul? Is it devil in them?
True.
You see, a few of them are the devil in them. Let us now turn to the seventh seal, Revelation 6.
Revelation 6.
Revelation 6. Yeah. They know that they don't know what's happening here. They know. They don't know. I mean, when you hear what is going on here, would you have missed it?
Not at all.
Yeah? But why is it that some poor thing would not come to here?
Bad mind.
Bad mind, yes?
Bad mind.
Revelation 6. All right now, the church is moving on. Let's begin now after 1, 2, verse 1.
And I saw when the Lamb opened one of the seals, and I heard as it were the noise of thunder.
Yeah.
One of the four beasts saying, come and see. And I saw and behold a white horse, and he that sat on him had a bow, and a crown was given unto him. And he went forth conquering and to conquer.
All right, now, folks, I'm trying to do something here, but all right, let me draw the line here. One here, hold on. I'm in the street, but I'm going to try my best, sir. I say I'm going to try my best.
Amen.
One, the seven seals. One. Two. Help me know.
Three.
And they have four and five, six, seven.
Praise God.
Okay.
Amen.
Now, you hear here, it was a white horse. Come on.
Yes, a white horse.
A white horse. And he went forth what?
Conquering and to conquer.
Now, we say that we're dealing with the church.
Yes.
So now, the first seal must represent the early church. The
early church.
Come on, right. The apostolic church.
Yes.
And we're not going to spend a whole lot of time on this because we have so many things to say from Daniel. Now, we all know that this was the apostolic church.
Amen.
All right. It was, number one, it was a pure church. Yeah. Why was it pure? Now, hold on. Let me explain something here. A church is not pure because the members are all righteous. Now, somebody is going to leave from here with the notion that everything was well. If you think everything was so well, look at Ananias and Sapphira. Boy, they lie. Eh? And listen, the early church even had some contention. Because when you read chapter 6 of Acts, you find that the Grecians were fussing against the Hebrews because they felt that too much attention was paid to the Hebrews and not to the Greeks. Come on, listen now.
Yes.
That's why the Apostle Paul, Peter, had to get up and say, listen now, let us choose seven men. There's seven deacons. Are you with me now?
Yes, yes.
All was not well. And then you think everything was well. Look at the two big men in the church. Paul, Paul and, no, let me begin with Peter. You know, God wanted Peter to go down and speak to Cornelius. But God knew that Peter would never go in there to a Gentile. Come on, are you with me now?
Yes.
And so God had to give him a vision. A vision that all these Sunday worshippers are calling, are talking about, saying that God changing the order of eating. So they can eat cockroaches and all these things now. You know, but God had to give him a vision to tell him, you know, help me now, that he should not call any man common unclean.
Amen.
And when Peter went back to Jerusalem, those Christians there, in the church, from top to bottom, wanted to cut his throat. So Peter now had to, it's a good thing he carried some brethren with him to see the demonstration of God to include the Gentiles.
Amen. Yes.
And it is the same church, early church, that Paul and Barnabas couldn't settle a problem peacefully.
True.
They had to split asunder. So I'm saying, the church had its problem, but it was pure. Pure of what? You see, a church is pure based on its doctrines.
Amen.
Not the people. It's what the church stands for.
Amen.
In other words, the Seventh-day Adventist church will never condone homosexuality.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Even though every other person might turn into homosexual, we will not condone it. Y'all don't hear what I'm saying?
Yes.
It's what the church stands for. Every doctrine must come from the Bible. So it was in the early church. Nothing was there by tradition.
Amen.
And the Bible said they went forth conquering and to conquer. You know, the gospel did conquer. Imagine on the day of Pentecost, how many people souls were baptized? 3,000. Church of the Lord. And then when Peter healed the man there, that was at the gate of the temple, 5,000 were baptized. And the Bible said that the believers were multiplied. You know what multiplied means?
Yes.
Huh? It means addition plenty times. Now, the church remained doctrinally pure so long as the apostles were alive. And that was from about the year 31, when Christ went back, to the year 100. The last apostle died about 100. Now let's move on. We got to move on rapidly tonight because I have so much to say at the end. Because I have to bring Daniel. Chapter 12. Move on now. Continue. The second seal.
And when he had opened the second seal, I heard the second beast say, come and see. And there went out another horse that was red. And power was given to him that sat thereon to take peace from the earth. And that they should kill one another. And there was given unto him a great sword.
Okay. Now, red means bloodshed. Now, it means that the church is under attack.
Yes.
Now, who you think was the mastermind behind the church? Wanting to destroy the church.
Satan.
It was Satan. And who was Satan was going to use now? Satan was going to use the greatest power on earth.
Yes,
and
Rome.
That was
Rome.
The Roman Empire. This is not yet the papacy. It is the Roman emperors. And what was the bone of contention? The Roman emperors were worshipped as sons of the gods.
Yes.
They were worshipped. In other words, Trajan, folks came and bowed to him. Now, the Romans were polytheistic. I'm using a big word.
What is that?
Now, tell my girl, sit up now, what, a mosquito bite you? Okay, go ahead and find it. Yeah, but while you find, listen, okay? Right. Now, I said that they were polytheistic. That means they worship many gods.
Amen.
Now, you and I are mono. What are we?
Monotheistic.
They are monotheistic. Yes. That means we worship what?
One God.
One God. Yeah, O Israel, the Lord our God is one God. So Father, Son, and Holy Ghost is still one God. It's a mystery.
Yes.
Great is the mystery of godliness. I don't understand it, but I accept it. All right, now. So now, when Christianity hit the Roman Empire, it was contrary to what the Romans believed, and the emperors were felt threatened. So they were going to wipe out this sect. It first began under Nero, when Nero burned Rome in order to get what they call poetic inspiration, because Nero felt that he was a musician and a writer of songs. And you ought to know this is part of history.
Yeah?
But Nero couldn't sing. And when all fingers were pointing at Nero, Nero now blamed the Christians. And so there was a slaughter of the Christians in Rome. under Nero, beginning with Rome. That's why Peter and Paul died under Nero. Mm-hmm. And then many others. And then came the other emperors. And they continued to slaughter the Christians. The Christian religion was religio illicit. In other words, it was a religion that was banned in Rome.
Yes.
In the empire. Especially under Diocletian. But Tertullian, a writer, said, the more the church was slaughtered, the blood of the martyrs became what? The seed of the church. Now, Satan is looking at something here. Instead, in other words, if there were 20 Christians here, when they killed the 20, 50 sprung up.
Yes.
How do you think Satan is going to feel? Now, Satan realized that by this strategy, was not going to work. Now, this period lasted, the Red Horse, from about the year 313. So now, what the Black Horse said now? Yes. Satan said, I'm going to join the church. Come on now, continue.
Verse 5.
And
when he had opened the third seal,
everybody,
I heard the third beast say, come and see. And I beheld, and lo, a black horse. And he that sat on him had a pair of balances in his hand. And I heard a voice in the midst of the four beasts say, a measure of wheat for a penny, and three measures of barley for a penny. And see thou hurt not the oil and the wine.
Now hear now, black horse. But that's why I tell you all, if we use our common sense, we will know exactly what this is, because,
yes,
it is contrasting the white. What am I talking to today? Folks, am I talking sense here? Now, if white represents the purity of the gospel, the purity of doctrines, then what the black would represent now?
Apostasy.
Come on, call it names, sort it out.
Apostasy.
This is what we have been telling you all the time.
True.
That the church was corrupted in Rome. It began in the year 313. That was the year. Let me explain what happened. Constantine and Licinius were fighting a war to become emperor, to replace Diocletian. Now, Constantine's army was much smaller than that of Licinius. But the night before the battle, Satan appeared to Constantine. Now, Constantine was a sun worshiper. He was not a Christian. You know, Satan showed him a vision of the cross. Would you know any other church that uses the cross more than the Catholic? They like the cross. Why? Because Constantine was shown the cross. And the vision said, a man appeared, said, use this emblem on your shield, and you will conquer by this. And sure enough, he won the battle. You see, here is where Satan is playing both ends against the middle. Trust me, one of Satan's demons, or Satan himself, because this is a big job, Satan himself did it. And sure enough, Constantine won. And when he won, he made a decision to free the Christians. And he allied himself to the Christians. Come on, listen to me now. So the Roman church that was now banded became the most powerful in the empire. But be known, it was not the religion of the apostles. Now, look where it is now. The headquarters were no longer in Jerusalem. It was now in Rome. Further from the truth. And Constantine played a role in deciding the doctrines. For in the year 325, at the Council of Nicaea, when they were debating whether Christ was God or Christ was just a created being, it was Constantine that presided.
Yes.
So the church that was banned now became a powerful church. And Sunday worship came in the church. Now, for some of you, I want to explain to you how it came. The Romans were sun worshippers. one of the main gods was one called Mithra. And so, when Constantine gave freedom, the Romans now began to flock the church. Were they converted? No, they were not converted. They came in still heathen. So what the Christians did, they said, let us worship on both days. And eventually we are going to lead them to the Sabbath. Both days were kept. Not only that, but remember, they were also worshiping idols. So in the Roman church now, they now began to substitute the idols of Mithra and Apollos and all those gods for Mary. They built images of Mary, St. John. Come on, you want to listen to me?
Yes.
And St. Peter.
Yes.
So you find all of these images in the church. And even an image of Christ now. So whenever they go in church, you have to bow to the image. Now, that is why the second commandment is taken out completely. The Roman church is bold. Satan is bold. He took out the second commandment completely. Now, this is the black horse. This is the same as Pergamos.
Wow.
The exalted church.
Yes.
Y'all remember when we were studying the churches?
Yes.
Yeah, Pergamos is the exalted church. Well, among the seals, it is the black horse. Ruby, you understand what black represents?
Yes,
the doctrines are no longer from the Bible. The doctrines are black. You understand that, though? So now, it is no longer the Bible, but what?
Tradition.
You understand, Ruby? All right.
Amen. Amen.
Now, let's move on now. This is now from the year 313 to the year 538. 538 was the year that the last of the Arian kingdoms was defeated. And so the Roman church was now free to go through the Dark Ages.
Verse 7.
Everybody.
And when he had opened the fourth seal, I heard the voice of the fourth beast say, come and see. And I looked, and behold, a pale horse, and his name that sat on him was death, and hell followed with him. And power was given unto him over the fourth part of the earth, to kill with sword, and with hunger, and with death, and with the beasts of the earth.
Right. Hold on. Now, we are talking about the Dark Ages, when you could not oppose the Roman Church. Here is where now God's church, true church, is in the wilderness. Why? What do you mean by the wilderness? Now, Ruby, I say Ruby, I'm talking to you. Now, the church was in the wilderness. I'm going to explain what it means. Can you imagine a time in the world's history when you could not openly worship God as you would like? See, you women are understanding now because we are free. If you want to worship God, in Trinidad, you worship God. If you don't want, you don't worship God. You can be whatever religion you want. Come on, you can even break away from the Seventh Adventist Church tomorrow and form your own church called Ruby Rights. No, Rubyites. No, I'm saying, but we are free. But there was a time when people were not free. In order for them to worship God as they would like, they had to hide. Some of them had to go way up in the mountain. Whole families, whole villages, whole towns had to migrate to the mountains and hide there in caves, dark caves. Hardly had light. They would plant their crops way up in the mountains. But when the Pope heard that they were up in the mountain, the Waldenses and the Albigenses, they would go after them there. And when they found them in a cave, they may meet 1,000 of them in a cave, they would light the mouth of the cave. And they would roast in that cave like meat in the oven. The church was underground in the wilderness.
could not be organized. Right now, the Seventh Adventist Church is organized. Now, you might know, Pastor, why do we have to be organized? Listen now. We are in a big world. We have to give the gospel to the world. Come on, listen to me. That's why the church has to organize. And thank God for organization, a general conference. Then we have a division to take care of a slice of the world. Then we have unions to take care of a slice of the division. And we have the conference to take care of a slice of the union. I mean, right away down, we organize.
Amen. Amen. Same gospel.
To carry the gospel. But at that time, we could not move it. Because the church was hiding. That was during the dark ages.
Yes.
And over 60 million lost their lives. By Rome. Slaughtered them. They were called because they did not believe in what the Romans were teaching. They were called heretics. You know about Hussein the Rome. You know about those guys in England. You know, Cranmer and Latimer and all those guys here. Oh, Mary. Bloody Mary. Murdered. Yeah. You know, strange enough. You know, she remained true to the Catholic Church, even though her father, Henry VIII, changed England to Anglicanism. You all don't know that. Yeah. See, my mother was Catholic in Oregon. Yeah. Brother, the sister of Philip. They were both the children of Queen Isabella and King Ferdinand, who financed Columbus. You all didn't know that?
Yes.
But if you don't, I'm telling you now.
Thank you.
No. The Dark Ages. The persecution in the Dark Ages lasted to the year 1517. By then, the persecution had to slow down a bit because the Reformation began there. Here's where the Reformation began. Go on now, reader. What it says?
Verse 9.
I get a heart. Move on.
And when he had opened the fifth seal, I saw under the altar the souls of them that were slain for the word of God and for the testimony which they held.
Right.
And they cried with a loud voice, saying, How long, O Lord, holy and true, dost thou not judge and avenge our blood on them that dwell on the earth? And white robes were given unto every one of them, and it was said unto them, that they should rest yet for a little season, until their fellow servants also and their brethren that should be killed as they were should be fulfilled.
All right, okay. So now, watch me now. The fifth seal is the Reformation. And we see here the symbol of souls under the altar. And the souls are crying out, calling for vengeance on those who martyred them. And they were told, they were given white robes and said, wait a little longer until your brethren who are going to be killed the same way. By whom? By whom? So the Rome that is quiet now is going to raise its ugly head again. But she's going to have a partner now. Now, let's look at the white robes. You see, during the Dark Ages, when these were slaughtered, they were considered heretics. But the Reformation now, hold on, the Reformation, beginning with Martin Luther, let me say, Erasmus, they said, was the morning star of the Reformation, but he never left the church. But he began to expose the church, Erasmus. But Martin Luther was the one that made a complete break. And when he broke in Germany, the princes agreed with him. And there started in Germany a protest of the princes. That is why the churches that came out of Rome were called Protestants. Remember, it was in Germany that the princes protested. All right now. So now the church. The church, Roman church, slaughtered millions of Christians. Christians. And now, on after the Reformation began, these heretics that they call, locally they call heretics, the Reformation now exposed the Roman church for its errors. And so these that were called heretics are now considered martyrs. True martyrs. Come on, I will now. Now, they were crying out for vengeance. And it seemed to suggest that they were alive. I said, it seems so. No, but I mean, if they are alive, then the rest of the Bible is a lie. Because the Bible says, for the living, no. And they shall die for the dead. And the Bible never contradicts.
Amen.
So now we know how to find out what is the meaning of souls on the altar crying out for vengeance.
Amen.
We got to find the answer is in the Bible. And let me say now, you know where the answer is? God put the answer way in the beginning of time. Because God knew that later on, way down the line there, that people are going to seek the answer. The first matter. Come on now. Now, we are dealing here with matters now.
Praise the Lord.
Here were matters on their own. Now, we have to go back now to the first matter. The one who was martyred for his faith. And the first one that was martyred for his faith in God was whom?
Amen.
Abel.
Yes.
And when Cain mattered Abel, what happens now? What God said? God asked me, is your brother?
Blood.
And I said, well, I don't mean, who asked me that for? See, a man that has done wrong is always rude. That's a hallmark of a fellow who has done wrong in the church and will not repent. He's rude to the pastor, rude to the board, rude to everybody. So Cain was rude. And what God said? The blood. Come on, help me now. The blood of what?
That brother.
That first martyr.
Right from the ground.
The blood of your brother is crying out from the ground. Don't remember that.
Yes.
Well, here it is, my friends. These are now the martyrs.
Amen.
And like Abel, your blood is crying out.
Amen. We get it. I think we get it.
It matters. The first matter this world has ever seen was Abel. And Abel's blood cried out. And now John is using the same language. You see, when John was going to write here, God showed him Abel.
Amen.
So Abel's blood was crying out. And now the matters are crying out for vengeance. And what God said, what the message was there? He said, you've got to rest a little while. You've got to do what?
Rest a little season.
A little season until what?
Your brethren.
Now, when is this going to happen? He's soon going to tell you. When the sun will pass, you're going to get a lot of trouble.
Yes.
You know, tomorrow night, we're going to talk a little about it. That sun is going to be terrible for 7 minutes. Some of us are going to die in the process. When the killing is going to stop? Is when probation closes. For the moment probation closes, nobody can kill God's saints again.
Amen.
Yes. Those Protestants that you see there preaching, they're the greatest preachers in Christendom. They're going to turn. All know they're intolerant. One fellow in Nevis, he said, a preacher, you know, I can't wait for the time to come to stone 7 minutes.
sorry the guy is from Nevis. No, serious, I taught the guy in school, you know, and he was dunce.
No common sense.
Yeah. You know why, you know what I mean? You know, why people are so gullible? Let's move on now. The next scene.
Yes, verse 12.
Verse 12, everybody.
And I beheld when he had opened the sixth seal, and lo, there was a great earthquake, and the sun became black as sackcloth of hair, and the moon became as blood, and the stars of heaven fell unto the earth, even as a fig tree casteth her untimely figs, when she is shaken of a mighty wind. And the heaven departed as a scroll when it is rolled together, and every mountain and island were moved out of their places. And the kings of the earth, and the great men, and the rich men, and the chief captains, and the mighty men, and every bondman, and every free man, hid themselves in the dens and in the rocks of the mountains, and said to the mountains and rocks, fall on us, and hide us from the face of him that sitteth on the throne, and from the wrath of the Lamb. For the great day of his wrath is come, and who shall be able to stand?
All right, now, as I said, we have come down to the meat of it. Now, let us go over to the seventh seal and see something here.
Chapter 8 and verse 1.
What it says here now.
And when he had opened the seventh seal,
yes,
there was silence in heaven
for the
about
space.
The space of half an hour.
Boy. Hold on. No. I said one verse.
Verse 1
ends the seven seals. After that is the trumpet. You see, notice what happened here. Under the sixth seal, there are three great events. Here four. It says one, there was an earthquake. Come on.
Help yes, me. Great earthquake.
Come on, are you with me?
There was a great earthquake. Yes.
Now, we believe that this earthquake happened in 1755. That is November 1, 1755. It was the Lisbon earthquake. Why it was called the Lisbon earthquake? Because it almost destroyed Lisbon. But the history says that the entire world was shaken. Now, the world population is not as it is today. Even with the world population like now, it could have killed millions. But it was a smaller population then. So, in an instant, 90,000 people died in Lisbon. It is said that even mountains covered them up. Ships at sea felt the shaking of the waves underneath, because tidal waves or tsunamis covered up cities. It was a massive earthquake. Every continent, Africa felt it. Europe felt it. But it happened in Europe. But North and South America, they felt it. And it was felt in the West Indies. Now, no earthquake was like that. Most of the earthquakes have been localized. Because even the one in Haiti that killed 250,000 people, we don't know anything about it. We didn't feel it. Moreover, it was only in Port-au-Prince. Because the rest of Haiti was untouched. But this earthquake touched every place. November 1, 1755. And then the dark day was May 19, 1780. Now, as it is said, history says that the day began normal. The sun was bright, cloudless sky, and then everything went out. The cows and the cattle went to feed, and the fowls were out feeding. And then by 9 o'clock it began to go dark. By 11 o'clock it was so black. All the cattle and the fowls and everything went to roost and so on. And if you lighted a candle, you couldn't see, you could barely, the light couldn't pierce the darkness. And people realized that this was not an ordinary day. It was a black day. And it was more pronounced in North America. And you're going to understand why.
on Sabbath. Why is it that in North America it was more pronounced? You see, God gave the signs where people can recognize it.
Amen.
Where it is most relevant. Come on, let's be now.
Yes, makes sense.
That, you know, for instance, the book of Hebrews, I'm going to show you something. The book of Hebrews is dealing with the sanctuary. Come on, am I right?
Yes.
Now, the Apostle Paul wrote it. Now, why Paul didn't write it to the Corinthians or the Galatians? Why? The Galatians, they were coming out of heathenism. They don't know anything about the sanctuary. So he had to address the sanctuary to the Jews.
Amen.
Who understood? Come on, who understood?
Yes. Yes.
But you see, it was in North America that they would have understood. Because the church.
Yes.
May 19, 1780. And then on November 30, 1833, was the falling of the stars. Now, there was the grandest meteoric shower. You know, all over the place. That night, storming, the heavens were ablaze. And people thought it was the end of the world. But it was a sign. Now, why am I going to spend some time here now? Let me look at my watch. All right. We're going to town now. I was in a crusade in St. Croix in 1988. And I preached a sermon on the seven seals. That's one of the sermons. And I was going to town with these signs. Signs of Christ coming. Why? Because Jesus said it. Jesus said, there shall be signs in the sun. Come on, help me now.
Yes.
And
yes.
In the moon.
Yes.
And in the stars.
Yes.
And now, when you look at Joel, no, when you look at Joel, Joel said it too. Let's turn to Joel, chapter 2. Joel, chapter 2. Reading from verse 28, reader. Joel, chapter 2. Because we got to get the connection here. Yeah, there's something that we all need to know. Joel, chapter 2, beginning of verse 28.
Joel.
Yeah.
Chapter 2.
And it shall come to pass, everybody.
And it shall come to pass afterward that I will pour out my spirit upon all flesh.
Yeah.
And your sons and your daughters shall prophesy.
Everybody.
Your old men shall dream dreams. Your young men shall see visions.
Yes.
And also upon the servants and upon the handmaids in those days will I pour out my spirit.
Move on, reader.
And I will show wonders in the
heavens
and in the earth.
And in the earth.
Blood.
Blood
and fire.
And fire.
And pillars of smoke.
Yes.
The sun shall
be turned into
darkness.
Into darkness.
And the moon,
and the
into,
moon
blood,
into blood.
Before the great and terrible
that
day
must
of the Lord.
Happen before the great and terrible day of the Lord.
Amen.
So all over the Bible, this was prophesied. So when I finished preaching tonight, I went home. And I received a call from Brother Edward Griffin, my teacher, my school teacher. And he said, Pastor, do you know that in Andrews University, they don't teach these as signs anymore? They are no longer considered as signs. And you ask, why? Well, some of them believe that these things happened so long ago that you cannot consider them a sign. Why has Christ not come yet? So for a moment, I had to think. Now, don't answer before you think. So when he said that now, I remember back in 1966, when I was in the hospital for a month, I sat there and read the whole Great Controversy through. And Ellen White, in the Great Controversy, I think it's page 333, referred to these events as signs. So what was my answer? My answer to him was, well, if those fellows in Andrews are correct, the professors, then the Seventh-day Adventist Church is in big trouble.
Yes.
Because Ellen White says that they are signs and she is the prophet.
Amen.
If the prophet is wrong, then we are in trouble. We have no prophet.
True.
Amen.
All right, y'all understand what I'm saying?
Yes.
Mrs. White says that there are signs. Now, who am I going to believe? Mrs. White or the professors? But I'm going to tell you who I'm going to believe now. Listen, the Bible was never written for theologians. That is the reason why these fellows can say what they have to say, because they are not soul winners. You see, Mrs. White had a third grade education. But now, whatever was said in the Bible comes from the mind of the Holy Ghost.
Amen.
Well, yes. If the Holy Ghost is telling the third grader what he has in mind, but he has not told the theologian what he has in mind, who am I going to believe? I'm going to believe the one that the Holy Ghost talked to.
Amen. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord.
That is why I don't care what anybody else says about Hebrews not written by the Apostle Paul. Ellen White says Paul wrote it. I know it's Paul who wrote it. I'm sure God is not going to use any unknown to write for a church that was skeptical. It got to be somebody of high stature.
Amen.
That the church respected as writing for the Holy Ghost.
Amen.
Now, 1998, I was in Guyana. And I was sitting at the table at lunchtime. You know, after lunch, men can talk. Because our bellies were full. And the food was pretty good in Guyana, in that hotel. Y'all don't hear what I say, no? I was sitting at the table with a few of the presidents and some other brethren. I remember one of my good friends, the president, said, you know, if these are signs, why is it that Christ has not yet come? Hey. And he quoted a time. 1755, 1780, 1833, Christ should have already come. And he was in a little doubt as to whether they were really signs. So now, again I had to think. Remember, I'm an evangelist. And the Bible was written for evangelists. For soul winners. You all understand what I'm saying, you know?
Yes, yes.
Brother, the Bible is God's plan to save mankind. So God already said that the wicked will not understand, but the wise, come on, who going to understand?
The wise.
And who are the wise? He that winneth soul.
Yes.
The wise are they that turn many
to righteousness.
And case closed.
Case closed.
So I'm telling you now, I mean, Pastor Lewis and I and whoever is winning soul must understand more. Because the Holy Ghost can trust us with more. There are many things that the ordinary pastor who is not winning soul will never understand.
Amen.
You got to be confronting people many times. Listen up, let me tell you. Many times it is in you when you are endeavoring to win soul. It's at that time the Holy Ghost reveals something to you. I'm trying to tell you all, if you are listening to this just to say, well, I'm seeking knowledge, you don't remember it? Not in a million years. But you now begin to teach somebody. And you see how the Holy Ghost expands your knowledge. You'll be surprised yourself. So, I began to think. And you got to go now, go along. You got to judge by analogy. Because in the Bible, whenever God is about to close probation, the last period is always longer.
Yes.
Yes. Whenever God is about to close probation, he always gives a long time, a longer time for people to repent. Now, let us go back. Listen now. Abraham was told, you know where they are now?
But your seed will be in a land for 400 years. And the reason why they are not getting it now is because the iniquity of the Amorites is not yet full. In other words, God said, I'm giving them another 400 years probation.
Right.
Now, when Israel came out of Egypt, the Amalekites, descendants of Esau, attacked Israel. And Israel had to know, Joshua had to fight them. That's when Moses and Aaron and Hur were on the mountainside. Come on, you remember that?
Yes.
And when Moses held up his hand, Joshua won. Come on. You all know that?
Yes, yes.
And then when he held on his hand, what happens? And so Aaron and Hur had to hold up his hand. Now Joshua won the battle. Now at the end of it, God said to Moses, write it in a book and rehearse it. Because in time to come, I'm going to wipe out the Amalekites.
Yes.
Well, my friends, 400 years later, Samuel came to Saul and said, God said, I remember what Amalek did to my people. Go now and wipe them out. How many years God gave them? That period of 400 years.
That is mercy.
When God said to Daniel that unto 2,300 days, then shall the sanctuary be cleansed. Then God said, 70 weeks or 490 years more are given to the Jews. In other words, I'm giving them another 490 years probation.
Amen. Yes.
Now, are you all seeing the trend?
Yes.
Well, my friend, the last event happened. That's 77 years ago. And somebody is saying, well, God is too long. But that is not how God operates. God is merciful. Because this is the last period. Now, are you understanding what I'm saying now?
Yes.
Now,
yes.
Let's go over to Daniel. Let's go over to Daniel 12. Turn to Daniel 12. Nobody seems to understand what I'm saying.
Yes.
Yeah. No, they don't understand. Let's go to Daniel.
Yes, Daniel 12.
Now, Pastor, read from verse 5.
Verse 5. After. What do you got it?
Now, read from verse 4. Come on, everybody. Daniel 12, read from verse 4.
Verse 4.
But thou, O Daniel.
But thou, O Daniel. Shut up the words and seal the book, even to the time of the end.
Yeah.
Many shall run to and fro, and knowledge shall be increased.
Now, let me interpret for you as you go on here. Now, this knowledge increasing and people running to and fro. All right, you say, well, Pastor, look at the knowledge. We have computer, we have all this. But that's not the primary thing God was talking about. Hold on. God was shutting up the book of Daniel until time of the end. Until when?
Time of the end.
Now, we have to know when the time. Now, what God is saying, at the time of the end, when the time of the end begins, I am going to unseal the book of Daniel, and men are going to have knowledge.
Amen.
Of the prophecies of Daniel.
Amen.
So now, it is for us to find out when the time of the end begins. All right, now, continue reading.
Yes.
Read verse 6.
Verse 5.
Then
I, Daniel, looked, and behold, there stood other two, the one on this side of the bank of the river, and the other on that side of the bank of the river. And one said to the man clothed in linen, which was upon the waters of the river, how long shall it be?
Hold on, Neil.
Yes.
Because I want you to get every speck of understanding. The one who is on the back of the river, what water represents?
People.
And nations?
And tongues and people.
So who now? The one on the banks of the river, or on top of the river, on top of the river, represents the one who controls all the nations.
Yes.
And that vision began in chapter 10. Come on.
Yes.
This is not Gabriel. But Gabriel does not control the nations.
True.
So that one on the, I mean, on the river, not on the back now, on the river, controlling the waters, the peoples, is who?
Christ.
Is Christ. So now, Gabriel and somebody is asking Christ, how long? Move on with that. Continue.
Yes. How long?
How long, yeah.
Verse 6. How long shall it be to the end of these wonders?
Yes.
And I heard a man clothed in linen,
yeah,
which was upon the waters.
Which was
of the river,
upon the waters, yeah.
When he held up his right hand and his left hand unto heaven,
yeah,
and swear by him that liveth forever, that it shall be for a time, times, and a half.
Hold on, the time and times and what?
A half.
And what? How many years that is?
3.5.
1260 years.
Yes.
3.5 years. 1260 days. And a day represents a year.
Yes.
Move on now. Continue.
And when he shall have accomplished to scatter the power of the holy people, all these things shall be finished.
Hold on. Now, who was going to scatter the holy people and destroy them?
Rome.
When this time happens, in other words, when we reach 1200, when we reach 1798, all these things would have been accomplished.
Amen.
In other words, the time of the end was supposed to have begun in 1798. That is after the time and the times and the half a times.
Yes.
Oh.
Uh-huh.
Now, amen. Let me put that date there. I want to clean this, but I need a duster. Okay, this can't clean it. This cannot clean it. Now, the brother gave me, Sheldon, one of them gave me this year, but it can't work. Sheldon, wherever you are, you did your best. Yeah, you try your best. And when you try your best, all we got to do is to say thank you. Now, let me put the date here. 1798. Uh-huh. Now, I told you all already that there are two climatic dates in apocalyptic prophecy.
Yes.
Uh-oh.
Yes.
One of them is what? 1798. And the other one is what?
1844.
Come on, 1844. Look at it there. These are the two dates. All dates meet and end in one of these. Now, 1798, brethren, is when the time, you know, it is not just when the Pope was taken prisoner and so the papacy received his deadly wound. Yes, that happened. But most importantly, it was the beginning of the time of the end.
Amen.
And the book of Daniel that was sealed was now opened up.
Amen.
So that people now began to understand on the 2,300 days. And so around the world, people began to preach that Christ was coming in 1844.
Uh-huh.
1844 marked the beginning of the cleansing of the sanctuary.
Yes.
Or the Day of Atonement.
Yes.
Uh-uh.
Judgment.
Now, let us look at these dates now. In the sixth seal. In the sixth seal. Listen to this. Look at these two dates. One of them is what?
1798.
Uh-huh. Now, when was the earthquake?
1755.
Come on, when was the earthquake?
1755.
1755. Come on. And when was the dark day?
1780.
Uh-huh. And when was the falling of the stars?
1833.
Come on. 1833. Well, okay, now, have you seen a trend here?
Yes.
What is happening, my friends? Hold on. What is happening here? This was the most important event coming at the time. And these signs were pointing or heralding the coming of the time of the end.
Amen.
These two.
Yes.
And then now, the next big event was what? The cleansing of the sanctuary. And so the falling of the stars happened just 11 years before it happened. So that the brethren, the attention will be drawn to this date.
Yes. Hallelujah.
All
dates meet an end? Either 1798 or 1844. Now, let me show you all something. Look at the last two verses. I mean, let's continue to read Daniel.
Yes, verse 8.
Verse 8. Everybody.
And I heard, but I understood not.
All right. Hold on. Why couldn't Daniel understand? The prophet himself did not understand everything. Why? Because God already said there, seal up the book. And shut it up, Daniel. All right, continue now.
And then said I, oh my Lord, what shall be the end of these things?
Yes.
And he said, go thy way, Daniel. For the words are closed up and sealed till the time of the end. Many shall be purified and made white and tried.
All right.
But the
Hold on. Yes. So what I mean, what is the persecution for?
Purified.
And to try us.
Yes.
Come on. You see, God will never allow us to enter his kingdom until we have been tried. You see, nobody is going to heaven whose mind is not fully made up. You got to be tried. And the biggest persecution is still in the future. This is the time of trouble such as never was. Nothing like it. Ellen White says that trouble in anticipation is usually bigger than the one that comes. But the trouble that is before us, no vivid description can ever come close to what it will be like. We can't imagine, just as we can't imagine what heaven is going to be like. We can't imagine what the trouble is going to be like. My friends, let me tell you something. If we know what the trouble is going to be like, many of us will cry out, Lord, take my life now. Let's continue. We're going to try. Verse is that? Verse 8.
Verse 10.
Verse
10, yes. Many shall be purified and made white and tried, but the wicked shall do wickedly.
Now the wickedly.
And none of the wicked shall understand.
Now, who shall not understand?
The wicked.
Now, why are the wicked here? Now, remember that God is here talking about Satan, who is stirring up apostasy. These are the wicked here. Let me tell you all something. Some of you are still confused. Especially the new converts still wonder if I should listen to this or I should listen to that. You got to be careful. After these studies in Daniel Revelation, you should know where you are.
Amen.
There is apostasy. Amola, apostasy is wicked.
Deadly.
Apostasy is Christ-like. And that is what makes it so deadly. Because if you don't know the scriptures, you will be deceived. What do you think Jesus said? Not everyone that said unto me, Lord, Lord. But he that doeth the will. He said, many will come and say, well, Lord, have I not preached? Have I not cast out devils? Then will I prophesy unto them, I never. They said, there is false Christ and false prophets. They are wicked. And what is worse about these is that they are leading others astray. Satan has the masses in apostasy because apostasy looks sweet. I mean, when you go to a meeting and a preacher is able to lay hands on somebody and somebody falls down, it is dramatic. Even though you never see it in the Bible, Christ has never exposed himself and said, go and tell everybody Christ did it. Christ always says, tell no man. But the majority of you who are not grounded in the scriptures, you are fooled already. So I'm saying now, these meetings are to unfool you.
Amen. Make us wise.
Boy, put that one in the dictionary. I'm serious.
This is to straighten you out, Tamona. So that you don't be fooled with apostasy. When I listen to the Catholic station, I am not listening to get truth. I'm listening to make sure that what people say, they teach, that I hear it for myself. But not for truth. I'm not going to go there and listen to TD Jakes for truth. No, the guy is eloquent.
Yes.
But that's words. Come on, help me now. That's words.
True.
The Apostle Paul said in 1 Corinthians 1, that I didn't come to you with flowery words, but in the power of the gospel.
Yes.
Maybe some of you didn't know that Paul was not an eloquent speaker.
Yes.
So now, continue reading, reader.
Yes, verse 11.
It says, the wicked shall not understand, but what happened?
The wise,
but the wise
shall understand.
Shall understand. Move on.
And from the time that the daily sacrifice shall be taken away, and the abomination that make it desolate set up, there shall be 1,290 days.
Right. Hold on. 1,000 what?
290 days.
1,290
90.
90 days from the time when the daily sacrifice was taken away. Until it's set up and so on. Shall be 1,290 days. And move on, reader.
Blessed is he that waiteth and cometh to the
1,335 days. Wow. Now, listen now. God is not going to put those 2 times there for joke. What God is doing here, God is saying, my people in the last day must understand the meaning of these things.
Yes.
So that when they see their faith in Bible prophecy can be cemented.
Praise the Lord.
Now, if we can find, we know that no day goes beyond 1844. Neither the time of the end begins in 1798. So these 2 dates are important.
Yes.
No date goes beyond them. So now, what do these times mean?
Tell us.
Well, if we find the beginning, then we can find the end.
Yeah.
All right.
All right. We all know that part of the Christian church in Rome was preaching that Christ is God. Come on, you remember that?
Yes.
And the other part was saying that he's not God. Right. These were called Arians, because it was Alexander Arius that really started it. Well, 3 of the kingdoms became Arians, and they began to fight and conquer. Boy, and if they had conquered the whole of the Roman, all of Europe, then we would have been
Arians.
Come on, I just know.
Yes.
But they have to be stopped. They have to be stopped.
Yes.
Am I right?
Yes, yes.
God had to stop them. So the King of France, Clovis, accepted Christianity and was baptized in the year 496. And he began to fight them now. He became now the defender of Catholicism. And he fought and fought. And by 508 AD, he stopped the march of the Arian kingdoms. He stopped them completely. They did not gain 1 more foothold in Europe. They were stopped.
Okay.
I didn't know.
Yes.
So that those kingdoms that preach that Christ is God began to flourish. Are you with me now?
Yes.
They now had their foothold. And that happened. They were stopped in 538. Sorry, 508.
Yes.
Come on, Irish now.
Yes.
So now, if you begin at 508, where Catholicism now was established, hold on. Now, the 3 Arian kingdoms were defeated completely in 538, but they were stopped in 508, so that they could not expand anymore. Because if they were not stopped, instead of 3 kings falling, it would have been 5, 6, or 7. But Daniel 7 said that the little horn uprooted 3 kings.
Yes.
Yes.
So when they reached three kings, they were stopped.
Amen. Amen.
And the year was 508. It was Clovis, the king of France. So now, when you begin now, 508, 1290 years later, you come up to what?
1798. Amen. Amen. Beautiful.
You want to get it?
Yes, yes.
And now, the next period was 1335. Come on.
Yes.
When you are the same 508, what do you come up with? 8 and 5 are 13. You want to have 4.
1843.
That's just the year before the great disappointment.
Amen. Yes. Amen. Amen.
Why are you so quiet?
We're taking it in, Pastor. Taking it in. It's sinking in.
Now, this serious part of it now. We all know that Christ, you know, the time of the end began in 1798. Men began to understand the book of Daniel and Revelation. It was made clear to them now, clearer and clearer. And that was when Bible societies opened all over the world. Missionaries began to spread all over the world. But in 1844, the heavenly sanctuary began to be cleansed. Now last night I was telling you all about the feasts. Now there are 7 feast days. 7 what?
Feast days.
Yeah, these were 7 holidays that were celebrating the plan of salvation. Come on, folks.
Yes, yes.
It began with the Passover. Represented the death of Christ.
Yes, the sacrifice.
Come on, help me now. The second feast. Now, what I want you all to do is to read Leviticus chapter 23. Now, the second feast was the feast of unleavened bread. Because, you see, Christ having died, he died for our sins. In other words, he died for redemption of our sins. To forgive us for sins.
Yes.
So, having forgiven us, he also... He justifies and he sanctifies. So that the feast of unleavened bread represents the believer living a life free from sin.
Free from sin.
Because
Amen.
Leaven represents sin.
Yes.
Then the third feast was the feast of the waving of the first fruit. And we know that represented the resurrection. It happened the morrow after the Sabbath, Sunday. Christ rose on the first day of the week.
Amen.
Come on, am I talking
sense? Amen, yes.
In the book of, 1 Corinthians chapter 15, read that book. And it says here, that Christ is become the first fruit of all of them that slept.
That's right.
And then now, 50 days after the resurrection was the feast of Pentecost. That was when the Holy Ghost launched the church. Now the next feast was now long in the distance. It happened in the 7th month now. All the others happened in the 1st month. But now, the blowing of the trumpet happened the first day of the 7th month. That's way down, which means that the blowing of the trumpet was going to be an event way in the future. That was when William Miller and others began to preach the coming of Christ.
Amen.
In other words, trumpet means proclamation. They were preaching the gospel that Christ was coming just before 1844 came. And then the next feast was the feast of the Day of Atonement. That began in 1844. When Christ went into the heavenly sanctuary, the most holy place. Well, what happens now, in closing? We are on the long stretch. Because there is no other prophecy coming after this. We are on the long stretch. Because very soon, our Lord is now making up the cases of all the dead. And when the time comes,
in the midst of the Sunday law, in the middle of it. Listen now, at that moment when everybody would have had a chance to make a decision for either Sabbath or Sunday. Listen now, this is not empty Sabbath and empty Sunday, no. This is a heartfelt loyalty to God. In other words, a thief will not hold on to the Sabbath. Come on, a liar in the seven Adventist years is not. You see, it's somebody whose heart is knitted to God's. Like Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. We are going to cling to God in righteousness. So we are going to hold on to God's Sabbath. And then on the other side now, those who are preaching Sunday and they are teaching Sunday, they now going to have the mark of the beast in their forehead. But the Seventh-day Adventists who are disloyal to God will have it in their hands. They are going to act it out. Well, at some point there, probation closes. It will close from the most holy place. And we will not know probation is closed until the seven last plagues begin to be poured out. The event is happening in heaven. Then what happens now? Our Lord returns. When he comes out the sanctuary, he will no longer be the priest. He will be the fit man. This is what the Bible meant to say, and at that time shall Michael. He's going to be the warlord. In Revelation 19, he's called King of Kings and Lord of Lords. You see, God's people will be at war with the devil. Satan is going to try his last effort to wipe us off the earth. This is no job for a gentle Jesus now. This is a muscular Jesus, the fit man. Michael shall stand. Now the Day of Atonement. Notice the Day of Atonement. On the Day of Atonement, when the priest came out, he took the scapegoat. He laid his hands on the scapegoat. And all the sins that were blotted out were now put on the head of the scapegoat. And the scapegoat was carried in the wilderness by the hand of a strong man, a fit man. So it is when Christ finishes, all of my sins, hallelujah, will be put on Satan's head.
Hallelujah.
For 1,000 years, Satan is going to be in this wilderness here, contemplating his death. My friends, we're in the last phase of it. The Bible says, and heaven departed as a scroll. And men and women are running to the rocks and mountains. All everybody. And they cry out, the great day, come on,
of the Lord,
of his wrath,
has come.
He's come. Come on, and what now?
Who shall be able to stand?
Come on, you all didn't get anything there?
Yes.
A question is asked. Come on, a question is asked. Who shall be able to stand? The wicked. Who is asking the question? Is the wicked who are running to rocks and mountains because they cannot stand. So they are asking, the great day of his wrath is come, and who shall be able to stand?
The redeemed.
And the Holy Ghost said, John, don't go on to the seventh seal yet. Pause. Let's answer the question.
Yes.
Let's answer the question.
Yes. Yes.
Chapter 7 is answering the question. The ones will be able to stand. Are you all understanding?
Yes.
Now?
Yes.
Chapter 7 is a parenthesis. It's a pause. Before John went on to the seventh seal, which is going to take us to heaven now. In 7 days. No, some of you don't know. That the journey from earth to heaven is going to take 7 days. Half an hour is 7 days.
Yes.
But God said, the Holy Ghost says, answer the question, who they are. Those who are sealed.
Amen.
Now let me say it again.
Praise the Lord.
Revelation 7 is not talking about dead people resurrected. It is talking about those who will stand.
Amen.
The two classes of people will be alive. Some will be going down. And some will stand up and cry out, Lord, this is our God. We are waiting for him. And he will save us. While the other one is going down. But thank God, those with a seal are going to stand up. On earth, we are here. On earth, John saw us look haggard, my friend. Haggard, my friend. But in the kingdom,
glory.
In the kingdom, it's a great multitude.
Glory.
I will throw that stood up. John said, the elder, when John asked, who are these? The elder asked John, who are these? And John said, I don't know. You see, you are going to read a little deeper. The elder expected John should have known, because these are the same people who are receiving the seal.
Yes.
And he said, Lord, I don't know. And what the elder said, these are the same ones that came out of
great tribulation.
What is the tribulation? It's Jacob's trouble.
Jacob's trouble.
And you cannot be Israel unless you pass through Jacob's trouble.
Praise the Lord.
I'm just throwing a little thing for tomorrow night.
Praise the Lord.
Wet
the appetite.
We got to stand. I say, some of us are going to stand.
Yes.
I want to stand. How many of you want to be able to stand? Will you stand?
Stand.
Pastor Louis, come and pray. Let's go home. There's a lot of information tonight. Honestly, I think that is why you all need to get the whole series. I am not selling. I'm encouraging you all to make a sacrifice. Get them fast. Master, let us pray. Pray for us.
Almighty and most merciful Father, the creator of the entire universe,
yes.
We thank you that you are such a loving God, that before you unleash your last judgment, you have extended a period of mercy to us mortals.
Yes.
And Lord, we ask tonight that you'd forgive us of our sins. We are in the home stretch, and Jesus is about to come. And because it's your will that none should perish, but that all should come to repentance, you have given us these meetings, Lord, to get our houses in order.
Yes.
And Father, tonight we acknowledge the fact that many individuals who will be lost not because of a lack of knowledge, but because of carelessness. Forgive us where we are careless. And in this home stretch, as the enemy of all righteousness prepares for his final onslaught, help, Lord, that we will be washed through repenting, through coming to Jesus, through presenting all on the altar of sacrifice.
Yes.
And Father, the enemy has us busy with so many things that are not so important. Because when we are down, when a man is on his dying bed, education and material possessions are not important. What is important is how he stands before his Maker. And so we ask, Lord, that this revival that you have started, that it will take a deeper root in our minds, in our lives. And help, Lord, that we won't simply be concerned about ourselves, but we will encourage, like Pastor Daniel said earlier in the message, we'll encourage our brothers and our sisters who aren't aware for what reason or the other as to what is happening here. Let them know that something great is happening here. Fill us with your Holy Spirit. Continue to teach us. Lord, your word is wonderful. We thank you for that revelation tonight, that the falling of the stars, the darkening of the moon, the great earthquake, all of those pointed to those two great dates, 1798 and 1844. And Lord, we're in the home stretch. We just want to praise you and thank you. And we thank you for your word, which says that they that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. Take us home now with joy in our hearts and praise in our lips for Christ's sake. Amen.
God bless you all until tomorrow night. Make sure you bring a great controversy and tell everybody what is happening here. That we are going to talk about the sealing of the 144,000 and a great multitude. Make sure you bring your money to get your series. Those who paid their money already, go to the back and get your week one. God bless you all. God bless you all. See you all tomorrow night. God bless you all.
Some glad morning when this life is o'er, I'll fly away to a home on God's celestial shore. I'll fly away. Die, hallelujah, by and by, I'll fly away. When the shadows of this life have flown, I'll fly away. Like a bird from prison bars has flown, I'll fly away. I'll fly away, oh glory. I'll fly away. When I die, hallelujah, by and by, I'll just a few